And I look at the whole religious scene today, and all I see are the inventions and ministries of man and flesh. It's mostly powerless. It has no impact on the world. And I see more of the world coming into the church and impacting the church rather than the church impacting the world. I see the music taking over the house of God. I see entertainment taking over the house of God. An obsession with entertainment in God's house, a hatred of correction and a hatred of reproof. Nobody wants to hear it anymore. Whatever happened to anguish in the house of God? Whatever happened to anguish in the ministry? It's a word you don't hear in this pampered age. You don't hear it. Anguish means extreme pain and distress. The emotion so stirred that it becomes painful. Acute, deeply felt inner pain because of conditions about you, in you or around you. Anguish. Deep pain.
Betsy and I followed a prisoner guide through the door at the right. Because of the broken windows, the vast room was in semi-twilight. Our noses told us, first, that the place was filthy. Somewhere plumbing had backed up. The bedding was soiled and rancid. Then, as our eyes adjusted to the gloom, we saw that there were no individual beds at all, but great square piers stacked three high and wedged side by side and end to end with only an occasional narrow aisle slicing through. We followed our guide, single file, the aisle was not wide enough for two, fighting back the claustrophobia of these platforms rising everywhere above us. The tremendous room was nearly empty of people. They must have been out on various work crews. At last she pointed to a second tier in the center of a large block. To reach it, we had to stand on the bottom level, haul ourselves up, and then crawl across three other straw-covered platforms to reach the one that we would share with... how many? The deck above us was too close to let us sit up. We lay back, struggling against the nausea that swept over us from the reeking straw. We could hear the women who had arrived with us finding their places.
God will use the foolish things to confound the wise. God can use a man without arms and legs to be his hands and feet, to prove that it's not about Nick. It's not about his ability. It's not about him and his strength and how he speaks all around the world and uses his hands greatly as gestures and body language while he gets excited preaching. It's not about me. It's about Jesus. I didn't write my story. Jesus wrote my story. He knew me before the earth began.
Great pleasure to welcome to Larry King Live tonight, extraordinary lady, Johnny Erickson Tata. At 17, a careless dive into shallow water left her a quadriplegic. Yet she's a best-selling author and artist. Her daily radio program received the Radio Program of the Year Award from the National Religious Broadcasters. She's founder and president of Johnny and Friends. You'll be seeing some of her extraordinary paintings through the show tonight, and she paints with the brush in her teeth. How did all this happen? What happened to you? You were 17 years old. Where was this?
Well, I was back in Baltimore. I had just graduated from high school.
That's where you grew up?
That's right. Had my bags packed for college. And
where were you going to go?
Western Maryland College, and wanted to be a physical therapist. So I ended up getting into it on the wrong end, I think.
Ironic.
So my sister said, hey, let's go for a swim. And I went down to the beach with her, the Chesapeake Bay. And there was a raft anchored not too far offshore. Swam out to it, hoisted myself up onto it, took a reckless dive into what I thought was deep water, but I my head hit the bottom, it snapped my head back and crunched my fourth cervical vertebrae, and I was underneath the water hoping that my sister Kathy would notice that I hadn't surfaced from my dive, but she was ready to step up onto the shore out of the shallow water, and a crab bit her toe. And she whirled around in the water to scream to me, Johnny, watch out for crabs. And when she turned around, she saw my peroxide blonde hair. I had just nice and easied my hair the night before. And it was kind of floating against the murky, water. And she saw that shock of blonde hair. And she came swimming after me and pulled me up out of the water. And I can't eat a crab salad sandwich to this day without thanking God for those little critters.
Will you?
Wait, think what remains. Think what remains is at the point of death, God told me in July 55, Revelation 3, verse 2. If a member of that body is suffering, the whole body suffers with it.
It's what we call my smuggler's prayer when I say, Lord Jesus, when you are on earth, you've made so many blind eyes to see. Now it's the same job for you to make seeing eyes blind, but you've got to do it now.
You've got to do it now.
And if he doesn't, then I've had it. I cannot outsmart the custom guards. They took 4 hours to search. Two fellows in the front of my vehicle, two in the rear, two underneath, and two standing there to watch the expression on my face to see if I was getting nervous.
All the time they couldn't find the Bible?
No, I've never lost one Bible in 20 years that I've done.
Hey,
I've never lost one Bible.
That there was in Amsterdam a Jewish orphanage where the babies were in great danger. Adolf Hitler had sent a message that the babies had to be killed because they were Jewish babies. And when I heard it, I told the boys with whom I worked, save these babies. And they did. They stole 100 babies. And I remember that one of my bravest boys, Piet Hartog, said to me that evening, "My, I feel so happy when I think that we have saved these babies." I said, "Piet, I feel so happy. But do you know that there is still a work more important than saving lives, and that is saving souls and bring people to Jesus?" Then Pete smiled and he said, "Oh, it is true, I'm a child of God. I pray, I read my Bible, I go to church. But to tell other people about Jesus, that's not my job. That's a job for my pastor." I said, "Piet, every child of God is called to be a soul winner."
I knew that even in the van of the secret police, I am in the hands of the Almighty God, and this gave quiet to my heart. I was led to a prison which is 30 feet beneath the earth. And for years I was kept there in solitary confinement. Don't think that I speak about my sufferings. I speak to you about the suffering of my whole country and of the church behind the Iron Curtain, which has given in these years innumerable martyrs, heroes and saints. I have been among the little and the weak ones in prison. I speak about these great heroes of faith. In my case, you can see what happened to them. For years we were kept, everyone alone in a cell. Never have we seen sun, moon, stars, snow. Never have we seen a man except the interrogators who beat and tortured. Air entered through a tube. Never have we had a book, never a bit of paper. When after many years I had to write again, I did not remember how to write a capital D. We lay on a few desks. We looked to the ceiling. That was all. Never could we hear in this prison even the slightest noise. The guards had closed shoes, and there was a silence which you could cut with a knife.
The sorrow, the agony of God's heart. We've held on to our religious rhetoric and our revival talk, but we've become so passive. All true passion is born out of anguish. All true passion for Christ comes out of a baptism of anguish. You search the scripture and you'll find that when God determined to recover a ruined situation, he would share his own anguish for what God saw happening to his church and to his people. And he would find a praying man and he would take that man and literally baptize him in anguish.